In 1953, on holiday in Weymouth, Philip Larkin was moved to hear his widowed mother, Eva, quoting snatches of poems by Thomas Hardy, which he had learnt by heart simply to please my father. He was prompted to reflect on his parents' first meeting, half a century earlier in 1906. Oh, frigid, inarticulate man. He met my mother on the beach at Rill. Before leaving, he had a picture of them taken together and exchanged addresses. And despite a separation of several years, his intentions didn't alter. I find all that very strange and romantic, partly because unlike the father I knew. He must have been as intensely idealistic as a young man as he was nihilistically disillusioned in middle age. After his father, Sidney, died, Larkin analysed the marriage with brutal objectivity. His personality had imposed this taut, ungenerous, defeated pattern of life on the family, and it was only to be expected that it would make them miserable. It was his parents' example that taught him his passionate antipathy to marriage, the monotonous, whining monologues that his mother inflicted on the family, resentful, self-pitying, full of funk and suspicion, remained in his mind as something I mustn't, under any circumstances, risk encountering again. The marriage left me with two convictions, that human beings should not live together, and that children should be taken from their parents at an early age. On the other hand, in his interview with The Observer in 1979, he expressed relief that his line, "They f*** you up, your mum and dad," had not been included in the current Oxford Dictionary of Quotations. I wouldn't want it thought that I didn't like my parents, but they were rather awkward people and not very good at being happy. Larkin claimed that when he later tried to tune into his childhood in Coventry with his older sister, Kitty, the emotions he picked up were overwhelmingly fear and boredom. It was all very normal. I had friends whom I played football and cricket with and Hornby trains and so forth. A school friend later recalled the intimidating tidiness of his house, its highly waxed furniture and the practice of hushed conversation, though Mrs. Larkin always welcomed him with unfailing graciousness. Philip Larkin's warmest recollections were of jazz. I became a jazz addict at the age of 12 or 13, listened avidly to all the dance bands of the day, and tried to learn to play the drums. On Saturday afternoons, we sat frowning intently in the glass cubicles at Hanson's, trying to decide whether both sides of the latest parlophone rhythm style series or Vocalion swing series were sufficiently good to justify expenditure of the record's stiffish price of 3 shillings. Sidney Larkin's influence on his son was intense and lasting. Sidney's political instincts were coarse, and he shared the anti-Semitism of many of his class and generation. As city treasurer of Coventry, he attended international conferences in Berlin, and during the 30s he brightened up his office in Coventry with Nazi paraphernalia brought back from Nuremberg rallies. There are virtually no expressions of political belief in Philip Larkin's letters of the later 1940s and 1950s, and those which are detectable show him leaning towards the left. He remained in crucial respects, however, his father's son. Sidney told him never to believe in God, and also imparted to his son his own adventurous appetite for literature. Larkin later recalled with gratitude that his father had filled the house with works by Hardy, Shaw, Wilde, D.H. Lawrence, and Catherine Mansfield. From an early age, Philip made full use of the local lending library. I suppose I must have read a book a day. He also took early to writing, pouring out prose and verse in abundance. Like his father, he used for preference a 2B Royal Sovereign pencil, and his handwriting, fluent and regular, is uncannily similar to his father's. Before going up to Oxford to read English at St. John's College, the 17-year-old Larkin reviewed his writings up to that point, burning much and preserving an anthology of the best, fragments of novels, poems, satirical playlets and essays. He had ambitions to be a novelist, but it was in poetry that he made his first real start. In the autumn of 1940, he sent 5 poems to the listener, one of which, Ultimatum, was accepted for publication. As an undergraduate, Larkin wrote a steady stream of informative and entertaining letters and cards to his parents, Pop and Mop, or Dear Family, sometimes separately, sometimes jointly. On Monday, I attended my first lecture, Edmund Blunden talking about biography. Very strange. The description of the matriculation ceremony is clearly intended for his proud mother's eyes. This entailed dressing up in all the full apparel. I didn't look half bad at all. Being blessed in Latin by the vice-chancellor. This was conducted to the accompaniment of bombers overhead. God, there are hundreds. My Latin name, by the way, is Philippus Arturus Larkin. In wartime, Oxford was underpopulated and the atmosphere muted. The age and specifications for call-up into the army were constantly being revised, and undergraduates knew that their studies might be interrupted at any time. On the 14th of November 1940, only weeks after he had left Coventry, the first major blitz of the war was visited on his home city, killing 554 people and injuring 1,000. Larkin hitchhiked home at once in desperate anxiety to find his family unharmed.
Dig, man, there goes Mac the Knife.
On the 5th of May 1941, Larkin met Kingsley Amis in the quadrangle of St. John's College, and they at once developed an intimate masculine bond. Amis demanded that his friend be an exact replica of himself. "I enjoy talking to you more than to anybody else, because you are savagely uninterested in all the things I am uninterested in." Larkin obliged by adopting Amos's tone of beer-drinking, jazz-loving ribaldry. He soon introduced his new friend to his record collection. Kingsley's enthusiasm flared up immediately. "I suppose we devoted to some 100 records that early anatomizing passion normally reserved for the more established arts." Amis was also an ally in Larkin's quest for poetic recognition. As editor of the Labour Club Bulletin, Amis published Larkin's poems Observation and Disintegration. His determination to be in the literary swim was intense. He became treasurer of the University English Club, and over the next 2 years was involved in entertaining a wide variety of speakers, including Stephen Spender, George Orwell, and Dylan Thomas. On the 16th of November, Larkin wrote to his friend Jim Sutton, "MacReady and I shagged up to London to attend a jam session at HMV Studios in St. John's Wood." He was filled with excitement at being present at an historic occasion, the first jam session indeed to be recorded in England. The young poet was enjoying his new experiences. He was popular and happy. He wrote to Sutton, who had been called up, with shocking candour, "Perhaps you think I'm being a bit selfish, but I just don't want to go into the army. I want to pretend it isn't there, that there's no war on." At his army medical, Larkin was told that if his eyesight was graded 4 or below, he would be exempt. "On New Year's Day, I received my hideous letter marked OHMS in bed. It informed me that my medical category was 4. Never have I, except at the news of the Munich Agreement, felt so relieved." When 3 poems appeared in Oxford Poetry in 1942-43, Larkin could feel that he was beginning to make some progress as a poet. After his final examinations, he glumly prepared his parents for that hallmark of imbecility, a third-class degree. But he was more successful than he expected, underlining "first" 13 times in a letter to Jim Sutton. The charmed world he had inhabited over the last few months was fading about him. On his birthday, the 9th of August, Larkin had submitted himself miserably to be interviewed for a job in the civil service. His application was rejected. In September, he was considered for a Foreign Office post doing secret work at Bletchley Park and was again rejected. Ashamed of his failure, he fumed to Amis, "I detest being inspected and weighed up and classed as unfit for this imbecile job or fit for that imbecile job or suitable for such and such lunatic task. I boil and spit with fury. Finally, early in November, his future was decided. I was sitting at home quietly writing when the Ministry of Labour wrote to me, asking very courteously what I was doing exactly. This scared me, and I picked up the Birmingham Post and saw that an urban district council in Shropshire wanted a librarian, so I applied and got it. Wellington was, on the face of it, an unpromising place for a young man of 21 to start a literary career. But Philip Larkin set about modernising the library's antiquated systems and procedures. When he arrived, the library's stock consisted of only 4,000 books, and his purchases of works by Lawrence, Forster, Joyce and Isherwood gained him a reputation for filling the library with dirty books. His life settled into a bachelor pattern. He played snooker at the local YMCA, he visited cafes and the town's three cinemas with local girls, and wrote in his spare time. In a letter to Jim Sutton, Larkin expressed a somewhat baffled respect for the quiet men in cloth caps who take out books of a rather serious kind with a serious expression on their faces, as if they are seriously trying to get a grip on things. The reading choices of the female library users disappointed him. I hate women when it comes to choosing books. But he involved himself in the needs and ambitions of the local library users. To older readers, he was unfailingly courteous, and his diffidence and nervous stammer, together with his patient willingness to find them books they would enjoy, won them over completely. One library user on whom he made a particularly deep impression was Ruth Bowman, a 16-year-old schoolgirl. Here was someone glamorized by an Oxford degree, mature, learned, and successful. I was dazzled. By early 1944, there was amused gossip in the town about the awkward couple they made. An acquaintance often saw them together reciting poetry to each other. She looked at him with such adoring eyes. The following year, Ruth, aged 18, was accepted to read English at King's College London, and her imminent departure prompted their first sexual encounter. Shortly afterwards, she wrote humbly from London, "The fact that you have made love to me is the greatest source of pride and happiness in my life." There is something ominous in her past tense, as though she was steeling herself for the end of the relationship. But Larkin was loyal, and the relationship struggled on until he met Monica Jones, the witty, beautiful, if also difficult and vulnerable woman, to whom he was to become attached for the rest of his life. Shortly after his arrival in Leicester in 1945, Larkin met Monica Jones, an assistant lecturer in the English department. Within weeks of their meeting, he had lent her the proofs of his novels, and very soon he was developing a protective loyalty towards her, intensified by the unremitting hostility of his close friend Kingsley Amis, who was jealous of this new rival. Amis had visited Larkin shortly after he'd taken up his post in Leicester, and inspired by a glimpse of the common room, had begun drafting the novel which eventually became Lucky Jim, in which Monica Jones features as the neurotic, manipulative Margaret Peel. Amis took every opportunity to ridicule his rival for Larkin's affections. Early in 1947, Larkin had been feeling particularly affectionate towards his parents. In May, he complimented them on how young they still seemed. Young, in keen response to things, makes home a very nice place to come to. But at Christmas, Sidney Larkin became ill. An operation for gallstones in the new year failed to dispel the problem. In February, he wrote to Jim Sutton that it was all up with his father. Matter of weeks. I feel that I've got to make a big mental jump to stop being a child and become an adult. On the 4th of April, Larkin wrote to Monica Jones, thoughtfully hoping that she had managed to recuperate from the strain of teaching before going on to relate his own news. My holiday was rather as I expected. My poor father grew steadily worse and died on Good Friday. Since then, Mother and I have been rather hopelessly looking at the stock in the house. This morning I shifted 100 pounds of jam. 1945, 1946, and 1947 years, and about 25 kilner jars of bottled fruit. Don't know what will happen to it all. I don't like sweet things, you remember. The only poem Larkin had completed during the last 16 months was Waiting for Breakfast the previous December. Now he composed what was to remain his only morning elegy, An April Sunday Brings the Snow. He told Monica, "It is snowing here at the moment." This accords very well with mood and circumstance, both of which are hardy-ish. Larkin was aware that this was one of his finest poems. It is an indication of the intensity of his personal grief that he did not publish it during his lifetime. His mother, Eva, was disorientated by widowhood, so he submitted to the ordeal of buying a house in Leicester where they could live together. The 2 years which followed were among the most miserable of his life. He was more certain than ever that what he, Larkin, wanted was not marriage. Women don't just sit still and back you up. They want children. They like scenes. They want a chance of parading all the emotional haberdashery they're stocked with. Above all, they like feeling they own you, or that you own them. A thing I hate. In March 1950, he visited Kingsley Amis and his wife Hilly in Swansea, where Kingsley was now a lecturer, and found this glimpse of married life decidedly uninviting. He began to lay practical plans to escape from his mother. "I do realise that my mother must live with someone, only I'd rather prefer it not to be me." In late May, he applied for a sub-librarianship at Queen's University Belfast, and somewhat to his surprise, was appointed. Only now, following a final break with Ruth Bowman, his girlfriend from Shropshire, did he begin a physical relationship with Monica Jones. He felt he could take the risk, since he would be in Belfast and Monica in Leicester, so their relationship would necessarily assume what was for him the ideal form, a written correspondence. The task of disentangling himself from his mother was stressful. Eva moved in with her daughter Kitty in Loughborough, though in her own mind at least, this was only until she could join her son in Belfast. Shortly after his arrival, Larkin's eye was caught by Winifred Arnott, a 21-year-old library assistant. Their relationship was never to develop beyond a romantic friendship, but for this very reason, this is one of the most poetically productive of all his liaisons. Winifred said, "He was a working colleague, 7 years older than me, already balding. They would meet over coffee, and at the weekend she would join him on long bicycle rides in the countryside. The decisive factor for her was his negative attitude towards marriage. I never did regard him as a candidate for my husband and the father of my children." The development of their relationship was suspended when Winifred left for London in August 1951. Within the closed academic world of the university, Larkin was becoming comfortably settled. In a letter to Monica, he accepted her envious perception of his effortless popularity and listed his cynical strategies for being liked. "Never contradict. Be pliable. Be funny." By all accounts, he was a witty and entertaining companion, imitating the Belfast accent perfectly and always ready with amusing anecdotes. Larkin's relationship with Monica was becoming more intimate and familiar. From May 1951 onwards, imagery of rabbits becomes a recurrent feature of their correspondence. Letters begin, "Forepaws, ears, or bun, bunny rabbit," in reference to their shared delight in the stories of Beatrix Potter. He adorns his letters with charming sketches of a rabbit in a skirt. The pattern of Larkin and Monica's future relationship was beginning to establish itself. He saw her regularly in Leicester whenever he visited his mother in nearby Loughborough, and they took holidays together, though never beyond the British Isles nor in company with anybody else. A number of her students recall Monica as a lively, inspirational lecturer. But edgy, defensive, loud, and with little interest in other people, Monica was not an easy companion. Though Larkin was the least political of men, her rigid right-wing opinions occasionally caused friction. His deepest instinct was to avoid politics, while his shallower instincts, contrary to popular opinion, gave him, at least in his earlier years, a prejudice for the left. After a holiday in the Lake District in 1952, during which they visited Beatrix Potter's house, Larkin allowed himself to express something of the exasperation she caused him. In my view, you would do much better to revise drastically the amount you say and the intensity with which you say it. You say you chatter like a jay. I don't say that exactly. What I do feel is that you've no idea of the exhausting quality of yourself in full voice. I feel quite unable to answer. I want to go and be quiet somewhere. Despite the dissatisfactions, Larkin remained loyal, and as time passed, his developing routines with Monica assumed the aspect of a marriage in every sense except day-to-day cohabitation. His domestic bachelor routines were established, and in the letters to Monica, he describes the prospect of tidying his own room with some relish. Larkin's friendship with Winifred Arnott had been resumed following her return from London in September 1952. But the next year she came home from a holiday with the news that she was engaged to be married. To his mother, Larkin depicts his feelings as those of a disappointed suitor.
"I am feeling a bit balked concerning her. My paw was raised to be brought down on her, and now she scuttles away into the shadow of a rock. Bah!"
After his departure from Leicester for Belfast in 1950, Larkin had developed the habit of corresponding with his mother at least twice a week. He addressed her as "Dearest Mop," "Dearest Old Creature," or "My Very Dear Old Creature." She called him "My Dear Creature," or "My Very Dear Creature." On Sundays, he made sure to fill at least 4 pages with trivial comments, advice, and delicate caricatures of mother or son. When either of them missed a letter, an apology would follow. This is by far his most consistent and extensive correspondence, running to about 4,000 letters and cards by the time of Eva's death in 1977. It was during his time in Belfast that Larkin finally abandoned any ambition to be a novelist. When Kingsley Amis began writing his first novel, Lucky Jim, the protagonist was based on Larkin, who had been reading drafts of the novel since its inception. When it was first rejected, he helped Amis with the redrafting. "We should be able to fudge up something good between us," Amis wrote anxiously. Both Amis and Larkin were caught by surprise when Lucky Jim was accepted by Gollancz. Larkin's importunate friend had suddenly overtaken him. But despite an occasional snide comment, Larkin was not embittered. He was well aware that Amis could not have written Lucky Jim without his help and support. He wrote to Monica in September 1953 with characteristic generosity.
"I don't think anything can stop it being a howling success. It seems to me so entirely original that my own suggestions really pass unnoticed. Even if he never writes anything else, it will remain as a landmark."
In 1953, some of Larkin's poems appeared in The Spectator and also began to be heard on the radio. One of the journals in which his work appeared was Listen, a small magazine founded in Hull by George and Jean Hartley. The Hartleys immediately fell in love with his work. Jean Hartley recalls their excitement at the poem's rare combination of wit, lyricism, and disenchantment. On the 20th of December 1954, George Hartley wrote from Hull that they had decided to venture on a book and asked him to be their first author. Larkin agreed. By now, he was beginning to feel that his sojourn in Ireland had run its course. In his next completed poem, Places, Loved Ones, the speaker meditates on rootlessness.
"No, I have never found the place where I could say, this is my proper ground, here I shall stay."
A few weeks earlier, the librarian at Queen's, feeling Larkin's abilities needed a new challenge, had encouraged him to apply for a post at Hull. In September 1954, Hull gained full university status, and in November, Larkin wrote to Monica to say that he had been offered the post. He was to start in March. A few days later, he reviewed his situation. He was now definitely committed to a career in librarianship. Monica, meanwhile, was doing her best to persuade him to marry her by the well-calculated strategy of sympathizing with his views about marriage. She conceded,
"Well, for one thing, you can't marry just because you think it's a sort of moral duty."
On the other hand, she suggested, reasonably,
One thing that does make me feel that we are suited is that you could discuss such an idea with me and that I can hear it without the least offence, and even with understanding. But being suited and actually wanting to marry is another thing again, too. It is painful to read her careful angling. Larkin responded after a week, tantalizing her with arguments in favor of commitment.
It seemed to me that if we were going to get married, this would be a good point to do so. We both want, or think we want, the same kind of life. We know each other well enough, etc. And we are aging.
But he continued with a cruel candor, which must have put Monica through the emotional mangle.
I dare say I could go through with it, but...
He concluded with a crushing, Larkin-esque aphorism. What frightens me most about marriage is the passing a law never to be alone again side of it. Monica could be in no doubt where she stood.
Michael Pennington was reading from Philip Larkin, Life, Art and Love by James Booth. It's abridged by Libby Spurrier, produced by Joanna Green, and it's a peer production for BBC Radio 4. Lending money to relatives is at an all-time high, so what does that mean for families? Now, that's the question in Call You and Yours today. If you've thoughts on lending to loved ones, you can call the programme on 03700 100 444. Call You and Yours is at midday. Now, just before the news, a word from Tom Heap.
More of us now buy cars with diesel engines rather than petrol. They use less fuel and cut the carbon dioxide blamed for climate change. So friendly to our pocket and the environment. But could we be paying with shorter lives? Increasing research suggests gases and particles from diesel exhaust are damaging children's lungs and triggering strokes and heart attacks. So is diesel a friend or foe on our city streets? And what can we do to keep our families safe from air pollution? That's Costing the Earth with me, Tom Heap, this afternoon at 3:30.
Shortly after his arrival in Leicester in 1945, Larkin met Monica Jones, an assistant lecturer in the English department. Within weeks of their meeting, he had lent her the proofs of his novels, and very soon he was developing a protective loyalty towards her, intensified by the unremitting hostility of his close friend Kingsley Amis, who was jealous of this new rival. Amis had visited Larkin shortly after he'd taken up his post in Leicester, and inspired by a glimpse of the common room, had begun drafting the novel which eventually became Lucky Jim, in which Monica Jones features as the neurotic, manipulative Margaret Peel. Amis took every opportunity to ridicule his rival for Larkin's affections. Early in 1947, Larkin had been feeling particularly affectionate towards his parents. In May, he complimented them on how young they still seemed. Young, in keen response to things. Makes home a very nice place to come to. But at Christmas, Sidney Larkin became ill. An operation for gallstones in the new year failed to dispel the problem. In February, he wrote to Jim Sutton that it was all up with his father. Matter of weeks. I feel that I've got to make a big mental jump. To stop being a child and become an adult. On the 4th of April, Larkin wrote to Monica Jones, thoughtfully hoping that she had managed to recuperate from the strain of teaching, before going on to relate his own news. My holiday was rather as I expected. My poor father grew steadily worse and died on Good Friday. Since then, Mother and I have been rather hopelessly looking at the stock in the house. This morning I shifted £100 of jam. 1945, 1946, and 1947 years, and about 25 kilner jars of bottled fruit. Don't know what will happen to it all. I don't like sweet things, you remember.
The only poem Larkin had completed during the last 16 months was Waiting for Breakfast the previous December. Now he composed what was to remain his only morning elegy, An April Sunday Brings the Snow. He told Monica, "It is snowing here at the moment. This accords very well with mood and circumstance, both of which are hardy-ish." Larkin was aware that this was one of his finest poems. It is an indication of the intensity of his personal grief that he did not publish it during his lifetime. His mother, Eva, was disorientated by widowhood, so he submitted to the ordeal of buying a house in Leicester where they could live together. The 2 years which followed were among the most miserable of his life. He was more certain than ever that what he, Larkin, wanted was not marriage. Women don't just sit still and back you up. They want children. They like scenes. They want a chance of parading all the emotional haberdashery they're stocked with. Above all, they like feeling they own you, or that you own them, a thing I hate. In March 1950, he visited Kingsley Amis and his wife Hilly in Swansea, where Kingsley was now a lecturer, and found this glimpse of married life decidedly uninviting. He began to lay practical plans to escape from his mother. "I do realise that my mother must live with someone, only I'd rather prefer it not to be me." In late May, he applied for a sub-librarianship at Queen's University Belfast, and somewhat to his surprise, was appointed. Only now, following a final break with Ruth Bowman, his girlfriend from Shropshire, did he begin a physical relationship with Monica Jones. He felt he could take the risk, since he would be in Belfast and Monica in Leicester, so their relationship would necessarily assume what was for him the ideal form, a written correspondence. The task of disentangling himself from his mother was stressful. Eva moved in with her daughter Kitty in Loughborough, though in her own mind at least, this was only until she could join her son in Belfast. Shortly after his arrival, Larkin's eye was caught by Winifred Arnott, a 21-year-old library assistant. Their relationship was never to develop beyond a romantic friendship, but for this very reason, this is one of the most poetically productive of all his liaisons. Winifred said, "He was a working colleague, 7 years older than me, already balding. They would meet over coffee, and at the weekend she would join him on long bicycle rides in the countryside. The decisive factor for her was his negative attitude towards marriage. I never did regard him as a candidate for my husband and the father of my children." The development of their relationship was suspended when Winifred left for London in August 1951. Within the closed academic world of the university, Larkin was becoming comfortably settled. In a letter to Monica, he accepted her envious perception of his effortless popularity and listed his cynical strategies for being liked. "Never contradict. Be pliable. Be funny." By all accounts, he was a witty and entertaining companion, imitating the Belfast accent perfectly and always ready with amusing anecdotes. Larkin's relationship with Monica was becoming more intimate and familiar. From May 1951 onwards, imagery of rabbits becomes a recurrent feature of their correspondence. Letters begin, "Forepaws, ears, or bun, bunny rabbit," in reference to their shared delight in the stories of Beatrix Potter. He adorns his letters with charming sketches of a rabbit in a skirt. The pattern of Larkin and Monica's future relationship was beginning to establish itself. He saw her regularly in Leicester whenever he visited his mother in nearby Loughborough, and they took holidays together, though never beyond the British Isles nor in company with anybody else. A number of her students recall Monica as a lively, inspirational lecturer. But edgy, defensive, loud, and with little interest in other people, Monica was not an easy companion. Though Larkin was the least political of men, her rigid right-wing opinions occasionally caused friction. His deepest instinct was to avoid politics, while his shallower instincts, contrary to popular opinion, gave him, at least in his earlier years, a prejudice for the left. After a holiday in the Lake District in 1952, during which they visited Beatrix Potter's house, Larkin allowed himself to express something of the exasperation she caused him. "In my view, You would do much better to revise drastically the amount you say and the intensity with which you say it. You say you chatter like a jay. I don't say that exactly. What I do feel is that you've no idea of the exhausting quality of yourself in full voice. I feel quite unable to answer. I want to go and be quiet somewhere.
Despite the dissatisfactions, Larkin remained loyal, and as time passed, his developing routines with Monica assumed the aspect of a marriage in every sense except day-to-day cohabitation. His domestic bachelor routines were established, and in the letters to Monica, he describes the prospect of tidying his own room with some relish. Larkin's friendship with Winifred Arnott had been resumed following her return from London in September 1952. But the next year she came home from a holiday with the news that she was engaged to be married. To his mother, Larkin depicts his feelings as those of a disappointed suitor.
"I am feeling a bit balked concerning her. My paw was raised to be brought down on her, and now she scuttles away into the shadow of a rock. Bah!"
After his departure from Leicester for Belfast in 1950, Larkin had developed the habit of corresponding with his mother at least twice a week. He addressed her as "Dearest Mop," "Dearest Old Creature," or "My Very Dear Old Creature." She called him "My Dear Creature," or "My Very Dear Creature." On Sundays, he made sure to fill at least 4 pages with trivial comments, advice, and delicate caricatures of mother or son. When either of them missed a letter, an apology would follow. This is by far his most consistent and extensive correspondence, running to about 4,000 letters and cards by the time of Eva's death in 1977. It was during his time in Belfast that Larkin finally abandoned any ambition to be a novelist. When Kingsley Amis began writing his first novel, Lucky Jim, the protagonist was based on Larkin, who had been reading drafts of the novel since its inception. When it was first rejected, he helped Amis with the redrafting. "We should be able to fudge up something good between us," Amis wrote anxiously. Both Amis and Larkin were caught by surprise when Lucky Jim was accepted by Gollancz. Larkin's importunate friend had suddenly overtaken him. But despite an occasional snide comment, Larkin was not embittered. He was well aware that Amis could not have written Lucky Jim without his help and support. He wrote to Monica in September 1953 with characteristic generosity.
"I don't think anything can stop it being a howling success. It seems to me so entirely original that my own suggestions really pass unnoticed. Even if he never writes anything else, it will remain as a landmark."
In 1953, some of Larkin's poems appeared in The Spectator and also began to be heard on the radio. One of the journals in which his work appeared was Listen, a small magazine founded in Hull by George and Jean Hartley. The Hartleys immediately fell in love with his work. Jean Hartley recalls their excitement at the poem's rare combination of wit, lyricism, and disenchantment. On the 20th of December 1954, George Hartley wrote from Hull that they had decided to venture on a book and asked him to be their first author. Larkin agreed. By now, he was beginning to feel that his sojourn in Ireland had run its course. In his next completed poem, Places, Loved Ones, the speaker meditates on rootlessness.
"No, I have never found the place where I could say, this is my proper ground, here I shall stay."
A few weeks earlier, the librarian at Queen's, feeling Larkin's abilities needed a new challenge, had encouraged him to apply for a post at Hull. In September 1954, Hull gained full university status, and in November, Larkin wrote to Monica to say that he had been offered the post. He was to start in March. A few days later, he reviewed his situation. He was now definitely committed to a career in librarianship. Monica, meanwhile, was doing her best to persuade him to marry her by the well-calculated strategy of sympathizing with his views about marriage. She conceded, "Well, for one thing, you can't marry just because you think it's a sort of moral duty." On the other hand, she suggested, reasonably, "One thing that does make me feel that we are suited
is that you could discuss such an idea with me and that I can hear it without the least offence, and even with understanding. But being suited and actually wanting to marry is another thing again, too. It is painful to read her careful angling. Larkin responded after a week, tantalizing her with arguments in favor of commitment.
It seemed to me that if we were going to get married, this would be a good point to do so. We both want, or think we want, the same kind of life. We know each other well enough, etc. And we are aging.
But he continued with a cruel candor, which must have put Monica through the emotional mangle.
I dare say I could go through with it, but...
He concluded with a crushing, Larkin-esque aphorism. What frightens me most about marriage is the passing a law never to be alone again side of it. Monica could be in no doubt where she stood.
The city of Hull was an economically depressed, unpretentious city, with a hinterland of empty vistas and vast skies. It turned out to be more welcoming to Larkin than he cared to acknowledge to his correspondents. He had happened upon the ideal solution for a man like him. He needed to submit himself again to his own customs and establishments. In 1979, he said,
"As for Hull, I like it because it's so far away from everywhere else. On the way to nowhere, as somebody put it. Makes it harder for people to get at you."
Larkin's correspondence gives no detailed account of his first impressions of his publishers in Hull, the Hartleys, but Jean Hartley was overawed. "I was greatly alarmed when I saw a dignified gent, slim, with dark hair receding, very formally suited, serious and quite unsmiling." Larkin's Saturdays soon fell into a routine. He would cycle into Hull, buy his groceries in the food hall of Hammond's, an upmarket department store, and then, with his purchases in a haversack on his back, cycle the 4 miles to the Hartleys' home. He soon came to rely heavily on them for support and companionship. Jean Hartley recalls him bowling along on his enormous bike, the biggest I've ever seen, looking more than life-size as he pedalled. He would explore the local villages, taking photographs of churches and landscapes. He settled into bachelor or spinsterish routines. Later, he told Jean that he took a lot of pleasure in washing out his own socks and underclothes. Very satisfying, dabbling and wringing and then seeing them hang out to dry. The university was embarking on a program of expansion. Plans for an enlarged library had been agreed under the previous librarian, but their inadequacy was already apparent. Much of Larkin's time was taken up with a busy round of meetings. He involved himself with the estates office and architects in the revision of the plan, familiarizing himself with technicalities of design and construction. Early in 1956, the project gathered new impetus when Bryn Mawr Jones, head of chemistry at Hull, was appointed as the new vice-chancellor. Larkin's new post imposed far more responsibility and stress upon him. In letters to his mother, he frequently expresses his diffidence.
"God knows how I shall ever get through the next few years building this new library. A sad life for an unambitious creature."
On the 27th of October 1956, he moved into a high-windowed top-floor flat. Here, Larkin was to spend some of the happiest and most creative years of his life. He had found his proper ground, and here he would stay. Almost all his remaining poetry was to be written in his rented attic. His public, literary and professional career developed in visits to London or Oxford. Otherwise, he became the Hermit of Hull. In the early days, glimpses of Kingsley Amis's literary success gave him a shallow discontent with his lot. After a visit to Amis in 1956, he wrote to Monica,
"It's not his success, I mind, so much as his immunity from worry and hard work, though I mind the success as well."
His friendship with Amis was now less cordial, but Larkin was increasingly comfortable in his professional role. He appointed Betty McAreth to the post of his secretary in 1957, commenting to his mother that she seemed all right, in a way. She'll probably stay all her life. Betty comments, "He was a very good boss. He took an interest in people. He spoke to people.
he impressed library assistant Maeve Brennan by his combination of shyness and bohemian style. At 32, Larkin was tall and slim, with a diffident manner and an embarrassing stammer. By contrast, his dress was unconventional by the standards of the day. Sports jacket, corduroy trousers, socks in vivid plain colours, and often a pink shirt, which we considered very daring. Like his father, he wore silk bow ties, and his clothes marked him out from the only other two men on the library staff, both of whom wore the customary dark pinstriped suits. During his first years in Hull, the library staff had something of the aspect of a family, and his youth gave piquancy to his role of paterfamilias. He made a tradition of the staff Christmas parties, at which he supplied the drinks while the girls provided the food. Maeve Brennan recollects, he joined in the long-extended congas through the book stacks with sheepish enthusiasm, going out of his way to put everyone, even the youngest junior, at ease. He followed the love lives of his colleagues, congratulating them on their engagements and sympathising with them during their disengagements. In October 1957, the question of marriage arose again when Monica's head of department suggested she might take up a visiting lectureship in New York. Larkin responded with exasperating indecision. "I'm simply terrified at the prospect of us going on year after year and not getting married. You'll say Mum is at the bottom of all this. Well, if she is, I don't know what to do about it. Do you think it would part us if you went?" In the event, she turned down the offer. In addition to running the library day to day and overseeing the building program, Larkin also had the library committee minutes to write, the bookshop committee to attend, and a yearly speech of introduction to the new first-year students to give, a task he found particularly stressful. By September 1959, the library move was finally over, and Larkin experienced a certain awe at the up-to-date facilities over which he now presided. He told Monica, "This building is like a tiger I've got on and can't get off." Later that year, as the library upheaval subsided, his relationship with Monica hit a crisis which changed its character forever. Monica's parents died, and she sank into depression. Loyalty was his strongest instinct, and his inability to console Monica at this time distressed him deeply. Protective sympathy, and also perhaps sexual feelings aroused by Maeve Brennan, produced a marked change of tone in his letters to Monica during 1960. Complaints about holiday disasters give way to warm solicitousness, erotic tenderness, and sentimental rabbit language. The fresh delight in life which he derived from Maeve gave him the emotional strength to offer continuing support to Monica. Her bereavement had set the final seal on her dependence on him. After this trauma, for better or for worse, he would never be able to abandon her. Larkin had encouraged his staff to take the Library Association examination. Half a dozen signed up, including Maeve Brennan. By the time she took the examination in December, their relationship had intensified. He was, Jean Hartley says, intensely in love with Maeve. Whenever he spoke of Maeve or looked at her, it was with a sense of having won first prize. Yet he wrote to Monica, "I did love being with you last weekend. I treasure the memory of your lovely looks, really, as I say, lovelier than ever. Beautiful, handsome girl. You're really horribly attractive, especially your legs, as you know." But Monica remained sunk in mourning depression. In January 1961, Larkin was introduced to Donald Mitchell, a music critic who worked for the Daily Telegraph. Mitchell suggested Larkin as a jazz reviewer for the newspaper. His first review appeared in February, and he was to continue to write monthly reviews for the remainder of the decade and beyond. On the 6th of March 1961, aged 39, at a point when he was at the peak of his achievement in both professional and literary terms, Larkin suddenly collapsed during a library committee meeting and was rushed to hospital. The next few weeks saw him subjected to extensive medical tests and deeply worried. He wrote compulsively from the ward to Monica. One letter runs to 18 sides, written uncharacteristically in ballpoint and with an unwonted unsteadiness of hand. He's effusively grateful to her. I must thank you, dearest, dearest love, for coming to see me so quickly, and for sending me cards and letters.
However, he refused to allow her to stay in his flat, because I'd left a few private papers and diaries lying around. Such things will have to be burned unread in the event of my death.
He was advised not to return to work immediately, and he paid for further tests in London by the eminent doctor, Sir Walter Russell Brain. He was visited by Kingsley and Hilly Amis, Robert Conquest, who brought him pornography, Stephen Spender, and John Betjeman. Brain found a deep-seated abnormality in the left cerebral hemisphere and commented, impenetrably, he has epilepsy of late onset with no positive evidence of an organic cure. Later X-rays of his head, taken in July 1969, were among Larkin's papers after his death. His life reached its apogee in late 1961. In Here, the fifth of his 10 great contemplative elegies, completed on the 8th of October, there is a sense that he has attained the still midday of his life. And past the poppies, bluish, neutral distance ends the land suddenly beyond a beach of shapes and shingle. Here is unfenced existence, facing the sun, untalkative, out of reach. On the 28th of December, he wrote to Judy Edgerton, an old friend from Belfast, that he had felt pretty depressed over Christmas and spent some time labelling packages for my executors. I really have no sense of the future now, except as the approach of death. His letters of the time bristled with edgy discontent. He grumbled about Al Alvarez's introduction to the new poetry. Says I'm badly dressed, too, which I take a bit hard. He lamented to Monica that he had done nothing with that fat fillet steak part of life, 20 to 40. On the 1st of October, Monica ruthlessly spelled out the truth at which he hinted. You don't like me enough to marry me. He responded characteristically by taking all the blame on himself. I do feel terrible about our being 40 and unmarried. She was socializing a good deal with one of her students, and Larkin experienced a certain jealousy. It gives me a queer, disagreeable feeling to think of you as someone else. But he made no active intervention. His mother was now 76. One of his Sunday letters to my very dear old creature in December shows his consistent, cheery, comforting tone. Hasn't it been windy? But what a relief to have it mild. I found my spirit soaring when I stepped out into the dark, rushing, rainy morning. It always cheers me up. Even as he was debating marriage to Monica in his letters, he was considering marriage to Maeve. The couple had reached the stage of tentative discussions about domestic arrangements. You'd have to give up work. It wouldn't do for the wife of the librarian to work. In April 1964, tormented by the fear that he was about to abandon her for Maeve, Monica suffered a nervous collapse. No tears, no reproaches could have shamed me more than your being sick. I feel quite awful, as if I'd, well, kicked something to death. Larkin's collection of poetry, The Whitson Weddings, had been published earlier in the year. To read the poems in the order in which they were written is to see the poet reaching fulfillment, then leaving his youth behind to embark on a troubled middle age. In the mid-1960s, a large shift was taking place in Philip Larkin's life. Public and professional activities came to the fore, and his poetry retreated into a more private space. He agreed to serve on the board of the Poetry Book Society, and in April 1964, he was elected a Fellow of the Royal Society of Literature. He was instrumental in setting up an Arts Council Manuscripts Committee to acquire the papers of living British poets for the National Collection. And in May, he gave his weight to the programme by donating his first workbook to the British Library. He was to act as committee chairman for 12 years. In 1965, he was awarded the Queen's Gold Medal for poetry.
Larkin bought his first car on the day that his new volume of poetry, The Whitson Weddings, was published. He wrote to Monica Jones, "I feel I ought to go out and see that I've locked the boot, and that no one can steal my jack, spare tyre, etc. Oh dear, isn't it all untypical? I feel as if I'd somehow slipped through into a different character." In letters to his mother Eva, casual references to his new status are mixed with the trivialities of his domestic life. Some days after her 79th birthday, he sent her a card relating how he had driven his car in for a service, taking the opportunity to collect my new dress suit and to take back a pair of trousers for further alteration. He told her about his new cooker. The doors were just about open, but are very stiff. How lovely about the azalea. You will be pleased. He inserted a drawing of a large-eyed seal in a frilled mob cap, bending solicitously over a pot plant on a small table, and ended, "I'll write again on Sunday. In the meantime, do please keep warm and dry." His stamina for chat and affectionate concern was inexhaustible. A larger opportunity for Larkin to make his mark on the culture of the age came the following January, when, following Louis MacNeice's sudden death, Oxford University Press invited him to take over as editor of the new Oxford Book of Modern Verse. Larkin also continued to perform the tasks of a full-time university librarian, although stage two of the library rebuilding did not offer him the same satisfaction as stage one. Bryn Mawr Jones, the vice-chancellor, and Larkin were pioneers in creating the first new post-war British university library, and their professional relationship was good. However, they had little in common. Larkin wrote jocularly to Monica, "BJ's the man in charge. He shouldn't be at large. I'm butter, he's Marge." After Larkin's death, Sir Bryn Mawr said, "People who have written about him have made too much of his poems and not enough of him as librarian." The tension between his relationships with Monica and Maeve continued. In a letter to Monica of the 14th of September 1964, he represented his affair with Maeve as in its last throes. "We're quite friendly and have to see each other daily. The real breach and dismay is yet to come, I feel, and I suppose it will come." Monica did not believe him and felt deeply hurt. 1964 saw a definitive shift in Larkin's poetry as themes of aging and death come to the fore. On the 14th of July, he wrote glumly to the novelist Barbara Pym that poetry has deserted me. When it returned, it took a new form. He wrote in the centre of the first page of his seventh workbook, "Never write anything because you think it's true, only because you think it's beautiful." He was returning to his aesthetic roots. In his letters, he continued to declare his love for Monica and for Maeve with undiminished intensity. On the 4th of June 1966, he concluded a letter to Monica by squeezing "love, love, 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 love" into the right margin. 2 months later, however, he wrote playfully to May from Hayden Bridge, where he was staying with Monica, "You know, I'm never anything but happy to take you in my arms and enjoy that kind of kiss that seems to be your own speciality." Larkin had his own verdict on this love triangle. "There isn't any need to make my situation any better sounding than it is. A self-centered person conducting an affair containing almost no responsibilities with one girl, getting mixed up with another, heedless of the feelings of either." However, it is difficult to see how he could have broken the stalemate. Despite what he said, Monica's abject dependence imposed a crushing emotional responsibility upon him. Maeve was also, if to a lesser extent, dependent upon him, but gave his life a freshness and spontaneity lost in his relationship with Monica. Neither woman wanted to be free of him. Both knew they would find no other partner so attentive and life-enhancing. In 1966, Larkin wrote to Monica about Maeve, "You may wonder why I don't end it, in my own interests as well as yours. Partly cowardice, I dread the scene. Partly kindness. If I've encouraged her to depend on me, it seems cruel to turn her away." Kindness did indeed require him to continue both relationships. And kindness required also that he take all the blame upon himself.
It's my own unwillingness to give myself to anyone else that's at fault. Like promising to stand on one leg for the rest of one's life. Larkin told Robert Conquest, "Life is pretty grey up in Hull. Maeve wants to marry me. Monica wants to chuck me. I feel I want to become something other than a man. A rosebush. Or some ivy. Or something non-controversial."
Regular short holidays with his mother in a spa hotel or seaside resort were followed or preceded by longer holidays with Monica. Maeve he would meet within the decorous context of the library and social events in Hull, or in brief snatched moments elsewhere. For several years in the 1960s, they visited Scarborough together on Christmas shopping trips to Roundtree's department store, taking lunch at the Pavilion Hotel. He pursued his own interests on trips to London, where he would visit Liberty's department store and share pornographic bookshop expeditions in Soho with Robert Conquest. He was working up to his limit and living a full and, in his own terms, fulfilled life. In addition to day-to-day responsibility for the library, he was serving on national committees, writing literary reviews, composing a monthly jazz review for the Daily Telegraph, and producing a steady stream of correspondence, personal, professional, and literary. In informal contexts, he let off steam in ever more waspish aphorisms. In a letter to Kingsley Amis, he commented on Ted Hughes, "No, of course, Ted's no good at all. Not at all. Not a single solitary bit of good. I think his ex-wife, late wife, was extraordinary, though not necessarily likeable. Old Ted isn't even extraordinary." When Ray Brett of the Hull English Department remarked that the second volume of verse by an academic contemporary was at least up to the standard of the first, Larkin replied, "You can't fall off the floor." Increasingly, Larkin was looking backwards, regretting his lost youth and disliking the overworked, overweight, older man he was becoming. He was aware of inexorable physical decline. He wrote to Monica, "Oh dear, I'm fat again. Needle well clear of 14 stone. Isn't it grim? I really must eat less, or something." To add to his sense of decline, his hearing was tested in 1967 and declared to be at the threshold of social adequacy. Over the following years, increasing deafness contributed to his isolation. His casual assumption that he would die at 63, the same age as his father, was hardening into a fixed prediction. On the 27th of March 1967, he wrote to Monica from Loughborough, lamenting that he was still tied to his mother. "I suppose I shall become free at 60, 3 years before cancer starts. What a bloody, sodding, awful life." Ever since 1961, Larkin had been writing his monthly jazz review in the Daily Telegraph. As the reviews proceeded, Larkin shows himself a partisan of traditional jazz. His earliest enthusiasm had been for the exuberant rhythms of black musicians. In January 1963, he wrote, "Trad, everyone agrees, is dead, but it shows no more signs of lying down than modern does of sitting up." He seems deeply personally offended by John Coltrane. "I do not remember ever suggesting that his music was anything but a pain between the ears." Some see this view as racist. But Louis Armstrong was also a black American, and Larkin's obituary of him stresses, "Armstrong was an artist of world stature, an American Negro slum child who spoke to the heart of Greenlander and Japanese alike." When the collected reviews, All What Jazz, was reissued in 1984, he reflected, "It now reads very anti-black, insofar as most of the people I bollock are black. Coltrane, Coleman, Shep. But then most of the people I praise are black too." He added with a twinkle, "Better play safe." The issue of Larkin's supposed racism only came to the fore after his death with the publication of his letters. The handful of racist comments, some of them indeed very unpleasant, are confined to private letters written to prejudiced correspondents. Monica Jones, for example, held right-wing views which Larkin did not share. But his self-irony escapes the notice of critics, as it no doubt escaped the notice of the original correspondents.
In August, he snatched a week's holiday in Norwich with his mother, in marvellous weather, followed by a touring holiday in Ireland with Monica in his new car, an enormous 4-litre Vanden Plas Princess with a Rolls-Royce engine. It was love at first sight, he told Barbara Pym. By the beginning of the academic year in autumn 1969, Larkin already felt displaced within the university library. There are so many new members of staff that I feel like a stranger in my own building. He was relying increasingly on Betty McAreth, who had now been his secretary for 12 years. As he told his mother, if she doesn't do half of my work, she sort of chews it up to make it easier for me to swallow. I'd be lost without her. Increasingly deaf, overworked and alienated, Larkin was being pushed to the side of his own professional life. His response was to engineer an escape from Hull, if only a temporary one. He wrote to Barbara Pym, I'm hoping to go to All Souls for 6 months in the autumn, a visiting fellow. My excuse is to finish off this wretched Oxford book, or let it finish me off. He spent the winter and spring terms of 1970-71 in Oxford. As his time there ran its course, Larkin became fatalistic and dispirited. As I feared, I'm drawing English poetry in my own image, and it isn't going to make a good book. Nevertheless, his choices among his contemporaries and successors largely avoid contentiousness. My taste, he bravely proclaimed, is much more akin to that of the ordinary person than it is to that of the professional student or practitioner of literature. The Oxford Book of 20th Century English Verse was finally published in March 1973. Every reader encounters a quite different Larkin Oxford book, depending on which combination of its 207 poems he or she happens upon. But over time, it has performed its intended function of introducing readers to the variety of modern poetry as effectively as any conceivable alternative could have done. In January 1972, Larkin's mother fell and cracked a bone in her leg. It was no longer possible for her to stay in her own home, so on the 2nd of February, Eva made her final move into a nursing home. Larkin was deeply affected by his mother's loss of independence. He wrote to Barbara Pym in March, reluctantly conceding that Eva would never now return to her own home. It's clear she can't go back to living as she did more or less on her own. Since Christmas, I've been going back there on Saturday and returning Sunday, which leaves considerably less time than usual for letters. Larkin holidayed with Monica in Wester Ross and wrote in their joint diary with disconcerting candour, My specs are splashed with lobster. My lobster's splashed with snot. No woman makes my knob stir. A bloody cold I've got. On top of his other reasons for depression, his unhealthy lifestyle and heavy drinking were causing a loss of sexual vigour. Larkin was by now a national figure. In early April 1973, he and Monica were invited to a garden party at Buckingham Palace. He commented to his old friend from Belfast, Judy Edgerton, Queen was pleasant enough, but I didn't have enough of her to lose my nervousness. I got on well enough with the keeper of the royal stamps. Larkin's professional life was becoming more stressful. Student numbers at Hull were growing inexorably, while staffing was being reduced. Between 1974 and 1977, there was a net loss of 13.5 full-time equivalent posts in the library, and the work was becoming technologically more complicated. A full-time archivist was appointed, and the first experiments in computerization were made. Larkin was never comfortable with the new technology, which he delegated. His mother was now 87, and in the midst of all his activities, he found time to keep her supplied with an unbroken flow of news and reassurance. In a one-page letter, he tells her, It's a grey day here, windy and rather chilly. He describes an interview with a local radio station about the Oxford Anthology. I had a nice letter from you this morning. Thank you for taking the trouble to write. I don't expect you've got your new spectacles yet, but I know they've been ordered. It'll be nicer when they come. You'll be able to read more easily. He inserts a charming cartoon of a seal in a mob cap reading a newspaper. There is something deeply moving about this lifelong correspondence, intimate, polite, and interminable.
Larkin's final collection of poetry was named after the high-windowed room in Hull in which he had lived for most of the last two decades. Now, shortly after Christmas, he learned that this room was no longer to be his. The university intended to sell off some of its worst properties. Unable to contemplate buying the house himself and becoming a landlord, he was at last forced to own his own establishment. In February, Larkin wrote to Judy Edgerton, making as much lugubrious fun as he could of his situation. "I have blindly, deftly, and dumbly said I will buy an utterly undistinguished little modern house in Newland Park. I can't say it's the kind of dwelling that is eloquent of the nobility of the human spirit. It has a huge garden, not a lovely wilderness, though it soon will be. A long strip between wire fences. Oh, God, oh, God." He described the upheaval to the poet Anthony Thwaite. "I've been V-upset. Feel like a tortoise that's been taken out of one shell and put in another." When he moved house, he did at last have to furnish his life in the expected manner. He bought a new washing machine and no longer had the pleasure of wringing out his socks and underwear by hand as he had done all his life. He mourned the loss of his simple attic existence. He could not find a satisfactory place to work, so he recreated his flat, sitting in an armchair by the fire downstairs, his back to the garden, bookshelves within reach. Larkin's poetic future was bleak. He was aware of having all but completed his oeuvre, and his inspiration was guttering. He was struggling to keep up his spirits. Yet to all outward appearances, his life had reached its zenith of success. High Windows was universally praised, and he was awarded honorary degrees by St. Andrews and Sussex Universities. His evening routine had now settled into a pattern. Gin and tonic first, food accompanied by wine, then a nap, followed by a menthol cigarette, and another drink before bed. Occasionally, he would host record-playing sessions with his jazz friends. His health steadily deteriorated. Early in 1976, one of the frequent estrangements from Maeve Brennan ended. Because the quarrel had lasted longer than usual, the reconciliation was particularly warm, and momentously, their relationship at last became fully physical. The new heady relationship with Maeve, delightful and fresh though it was not as simply serene for him as it seemed to her. When she went on a trip to Ireland, leaving Larkin to take his regular holiday in Scotland with Monica, he felt unaccountably bereft. He wrote to her on the 7th of August. "I wish you hadn't gone away just when you did. I miss you." A decade and a half after their relationship had begun, Larkin remained caught with a new intensity between his love for Maeve and his duty to Monica. When, later in the month, he travelled to Buckingham Palace for the CBE award ceremony, it was, of course, Monica who accompanied him. At this point, Larkin transformed his situation in the most dramatic and creative way. He brought a third woman into his life by initiating a love affair with his secretary of 18 years, Betty McAreth. After they became intimate, she immediately told him, "Don't worry, Philip. I will never, ever say a word to anybody." Nor did she, until more than a decade later, when Andrew Motion finally riddled out the clues. She has never forgiven him. Betty, as she says with precision, was not in love with him, but over the years had grown to love him. They were both in their early 50s. It would soon be too late. Betty recalls, "The whole thing took me by surprise. As far as I was concerned, we could have gone on as we were. We were good buddies." She felt excited by the new relationship, not having expected such a thing at her time of life. One element which drew them together was her attitude to marriage. As she says, "I knew all along, deep down, that I would never, ever in this life get married." On the other hand, her relationship with Larkin had some aspects of a marriage. "I knew everything a wife knows, more than some wives know, probably." She was enough of a woman of the world to be unconcerned by his taste for pornography, and the affair was happy and long-lasting. Over the remaining years, until Monica came to live in Newland Park, Betty would visit him in the evenings. By this time, their written correspondence in decline, Larkin rang Monica every night at 8 o'clock, and they spoke for an hour. If, by chance, Betty did happen to be there earlier, he would have to leave her in bed and go downstairs for the phone call with Monica. Betty recalls, and if he didn't ring, she would have to know why. Where had he been? What had he been doing? In 1975 and 1976, Larkin wrote four substantial poems addressed to Betty. She recalls the debates between them. He said to me one day, I can't understand why you, on waking in the morning, don't think of death. And I just looked at him, and I said, I cannot understand why you, on waking in the morning, think of death. He said to me, my father died when he was 63, and I expect I shall die when I'm 63. And I said, yes, you will, because you are programming yourself to die at 63. On the 17th of November, 1977, came the death that mattered most. His mother died at the age of 91. His dearest old creature was no longer there to expect his next letter. The following day, Larkin kept an appointment with Anthony Thwaite at All Souls College and asked his Anglican friend to accompany him to college prayers in the morning. I think my mother would have liked that. Early the following spring, Larkin finally and momentously sorted himself out in relation to Maeve. I still find it distressing to recall the details, let alone write about them, she said. Philip had finally determined to end the vacillation of 18 years and henceforth pledge himself to Monica Jones. I reluctantly accepted his decision. What else could I do? Larkin wrote to her. I realize you're very hurt and that this explains the angry home truths. I know most of these are justified, not quite all, but they leave their sting. Perhaps when we feel better, we can meet again. I don't say this vindictively. I am extremely sad about it all. Dismay and puzzlement at Larkin's poor image of being a Tory snob with sexist and racist tendencies and a singularly unattractive man is universal among the women with whom he was romantically involved. All those who were close to him remember him with affection and feel privileged to have known him. Typically, they found him witty, entertaining, considerate, and kind. In March 1979, Larkin had seen a hedgehog several times in his back garden and had fed and taken photographs of it. Then, in June, he wrote to Judy Edgerton, "This has been rather a depressing day. Killed a hedgehog when mowing the lawn. By accident, of course. It's upset me, rather." With Betty the following morning, he was less reticent. She recollects, "This day was different from anything. He just stood at the window of his office, looking out, and said, 'I mowed the lawn last night and I killed the hedgehog.' And the tears rolled down his face." Later that year, Larkin agreed to give two interviews intended to consolidate his public image. The first, with Miriam Gross of The Observer, appeared in November and is packed with brittle and outrageous aphorisms as quotable as anything in Oscar Wilde. He dislikes public readings, he says, because I don't want to go around pretending to be me. You can't write more than 2 hours a day, and after that, what do you do? Probably get into trouble. Writing a poem makes him feel as if he'd laid an egg. In Philistine mode, he tells his interviewer, "I read everything, except philosophy, theology, economics, sociology, science, or anything to do with the wonders of nature, anything to do with technology. Oh, have I said politics?" He would like to visit China, but only if he could come back the same day. The Observer interview is his most exhilarating exercise in high camp wit, though there is also something of the self-epitaph about it. He simplifies his life into a delightful self-parody, claiming to have completely forgotten his childhood and wanly characterizing his parents as not very good at being happy. Librarianship was a good choice of profession for him, he claims, since it has just the right blend of academic interest and administration that seems to match my particular talents, such as they are. He likes living in Hull because it is on the way to nowhere. It's in the middle of this lonely country, and beyond, there's only the sea. I like that. His final comment has persuasive gravity.
I want readers to feel, yes, I've never thought of it that way, but that's how it is. Lunching with a young colleague in the staff canteen of Hull University a few months before he died in 1985, at the age of 63, Larkin asked her how old she was. She told him she was 31. Looking down at his failing body, he declared passionately, "It's not fair."
In 1984, Philip Larkin declined to accept the post of Poet Laureate. After his death in 1985, Monica Jones lived on in his house in Hull until her death in 2001. Philip Larkin, Life, Art and Love by James Booth, was read by Michael Pennington, abridged by Libby Spurrier and produced by Joanna Green. It was a peer production for BBC Radio 4.